Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching a brand new edition of India's World with me, Frank Razan Pereira. India and Saudi Arabia will sign a raft of key pacts to significantly ramp up ties in several key sectors, including oil and gas, renewable energy and civil aviation during Prime Minister Narendra Modi's visit to the Gulf nation. The major pacts to be signed include an agreement to launch an India-Saudi Arabia Strategic Partnership Council, an MOU to roll out RuPay Card, India's digital payment system, and a separate one on bringing coordination between e-migration systems of the two countries. Briefing reporters on the Prime Minister's visit, Secretary Economic Relations and the External Affairs Ministry, T.S. Tirumurthy, said both sides will also deliberate on further enhancing defence and security cooperation, adding the first naval exercise between the two nations will take place by the end of this year or early next year. In Saudi's capital Riyadh, the Prime Minister will meet Saudi King Salman bin Abdulaziz Al Saud and hold delegation-level talks with Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman on October 29th. On this edition of India's World, we will analyse the bilateral ties between India and Saudi Arabia. Joining me on the programme today are Pramit Pal Chaudhary, Foreign Affairs Editor of the Hindustan Times, Professor A.K. Pasha, Centre for West Asian Studies, JNU, and B.S. Prakash, former ambassador. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of India's World. Ambassador, I'd like to begin the program with you. Let's first try and analyze and try to put into perspective what is the status of the bilateral relationship between India and Saudi Arabia as things stand at the moment.
It would be very safe to say that Saudi Arabia has always been an important country for India and vice versa. I served in Saudi Arabia a long time ago, if I am allowed to personalize this for a moment. Even then, and this was 30 years ago, on two or three aspects of the relationship, it was always important. One was the energy link. The other was the connectivity with the Indian professionals and workers there. The size of our community there, which has grown multiple times since then. And the remittances that they sent. But that's completely different today in the sense that it's a multi-dimensional and a much more substantive relationship. As you said in your introduction, now we call it a strategic partnership. So from a relationship focused on the economy, energy, now it's much more than all that. I guess we will go into the details now. So I would say that the status of the bilateral relationship is an important one, a substantive one. There are many convergences, some differences in perspectives, some areas where we need to sort out issues. So it's a complex and interesting and important relationship.
Okay, all right, Professor, I'd like to bring you in now. How has the relationship evolved over the recent past? You know, a few years ago, Saudi establishment was very close to Pakistan. But in the recent times, we've seen that Saudi Arabia has come out openly in support of India as well on many of the issues. So how has the relationship evolved in recent times?
Yeah, the turning point one should trace to 9/11. This, I think, is a turning point in Saudi foreign policy. After that, they have been looking towards the East, China, India and other countries. And the first step was the invitation to the former Saudi King Abdullah for the Republic Day parade in 2006. And after that, the relations have really picked up. And one can say in the last 12 years, you know, the achievements have been so many that it was unimaginable. You know, not only the oil and energy security has taken to new heights, but also now it is defense and cooperation in intelligence and security affairs. And also naval exercises. You know, Saudis are quite worried about the rise of Iran in the Gulf region and also about this flip-flop with their ally, the United States. Sometimes President Trump says the Saudi monarchy cannot survive without our support for 10 days. And the next breath he sends troops to defend the Saudi kingdom against its enemies. So in that way, the Saudis have been evolving over a period of time. But Indo-Saudi relations now, I think, have matured. I mean, not only regular meetings at the foreign ministry level and also national security advisors level, but also at the political level. This is, I think, the third visit by the Prime Minister. During his first visit, he got the highest civilian award, and then last year and now, which speaks, because the first king to arrive in India was 1956, and then there was a gap up to 2005. So it was a big gap, so-called communication gap. Only Mrs. Gandhi visited in 82. But if you survey since 2006, the relationship has matured with high-level visits and also meetings, not only the joint commission, but also the highest political defense and security level. So there is maturity. And also, I think the Saudis have understood our areas of preference, whether it is OIC or Kashmir or Pakistan, or our attempt to have good relations with as many countries as possible, because Iran is a major issue in the bilateral relationship, like Pakistan was before. Now they have dehyphenated these two issues. So in that way, I think Indo-Saudi relations are progressing well, and I think there is greater understanding for better relations in future.
All right. So during the visit of the Prime Minister to Saudi Arabia, Pramit, the issue of Iran, like the professor has just pointed out, is that likely to come up? And also talking about the evolution of, you know, of Saudi Arabia and its foreign policy, we have to look at the evolution of India's policy as well, and how we've been able to be friends both with Saudi Arabia and Saudi Arabia's bitter enemy, Iran.
Well, the entire policy, I would argue, for India and the Middle East, if you wish, or West Asia, has been to maintain a set of bilateral relations and try to ensure that none of them get entangled with each other. So it's not only Iran and Saudi Arabia, it's also Israel, it is the UAE, and it is Oman. So we maintain a set of bilateral relations, and we make it very clear that we will not take sides in their disputes with each other. So therefore, that's the balancing act that we have maintained. The difference now is that we have a lot more bilateral relationships than we had even 10 or 15 years ago. Israel is a new one that's in many ways has emerged over the past two decades. Saudi Arabia is a new one, and the UAE is rising possibly as one of our most, if not most important relationship in the Gulf. And that's a new, many ways a new relationship in terms of its character. I would expect that when India has already agreed, partly because we have no choice, to the sanctions that have been imposed on Iran and reduced our purchases of Iranian oil. I don't think that's anything more is expected of us from anybody, and we've made it clear we're not going to go beyond that. So I don't expect Iran to be part of the dialogue at all. I think instead what we will do is try to explain, because Saudi Arabia has backed us, and they probably but still would require us to give some explanation of why the Kashmir policy has changed and why India believes that Pakistan is now irrelevant to what is happening in Kashmir. And in many ways, that is one of the biggest shifts has been the fact that, Professor Pasha has mentioned, they have kept their Pakistan policy separate from their India policy. And so these are now two separate issues, and we're no longer going to allow our concerns, our relationship with Pakistan, to affect our relationship with you. So on Kashmir, they've been completely silent or supportive, in fact, as far as India's policies are concerned. The second element we'll see, as has been mentioned, we now have an energy relationship. We've always had an energy relationship, but now it's no longer just the import of oil. Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman had promised $100 billion investments in India, and the bulk of that is going to be in the petrochemical field. King Abdullah, as mentioned, had come to visit us in Republic Day, had broken a sort of 30 to 40 year gap of high level Saudi visits to India. And one of the things he had said even then is that the future of India's energy requirements, Saudi Arabia can act as the guarantor. But he also had said then that we will invest and develop a footprint in your country in petrochemicals and in energy, similar to what we used to have in the United States. So this is now continuing under MBS, but now he's actually putting some money on the ground. So you've seen the reports that they're considering buying a big stake in Reliance. They're considering a huge refinery in Maharashtra. We're now expecting them to make an announcement, possibly on this visit, of an interest in the newly privatized BPCL, when that's put on the block by the government. So overall, from what I've heard, they have, and there probably another, there's another petrochemical deal in the offing from what I've heard. So you have a whole set of them, but the game is now investment, not just the supply of oil. Lots of countries supply us oil, and then lots of countries, there's now a surplus of oil in the world. But the big difference is that they're prepared to put this enormous money on the table. And I should add that one of the things that is often forgotten, Saudi Arabia is a huge investor in our tech industry, in unicorns, startups. Saudi Arabia has put over $10 billion already through SoftBank, and are expanding their investments in, on the Indian tech side. And I think the final element now is the military relationship, which until now has been relatively non-existent. And with these new naval exercises and so on, we'll start to see an element of that as well.
Right. All right. So, Ambassador, let's talk about some sticking points now and probably some areas of differences and some areas of concern that we need to watch out for going forward and that need special attention maybe.
I think let's start with the fact that the region, you can't really say that it's a stable region or we are not free of concern, and that includes the countries themselves. So we already referred to the differences, divergences, it's more than that, between Saudi Arabia and Iran. There has been some talk now of Saudi Arabia being perhaps showing a little flexibility. There are these reports about Saudi Arabia saying that yes, Imran Khan of Pakistan, for instance, traveled both to Tehran and was in Riyadh. But all this has not gone anywhere. So one of the primary reasons for concern, for instability for the countries concerned, but also for the region and for the world, is what's happening between Saudi Arabia and Iran. The enduring sense of, if not hostility, the enduring sense of divergences. Then we also have problems with Yemen that Saudi Arabia faces, and we saw these attacks, the drone attacks on the one hand, and then also the attacks on the Iranian oil tanker. So it is not as if these are only in terms of only talk. We have seen disturbances happen, and what happened when there were these drone attacks in Saudi Arabia was serious, did cause a sudden spurt in oil prices. So, when we look at this region, for us, the immediate concerns, the very tangible concerns, first of all, would be security of supplies. That, I think, one way or the other can be secured, and we don't really see disruption at this stage. But supposing there is a scare, and supposing something were to erupt in whatever scale, we have 8 million Indians in the Gulf region and something like nearly 3 million in Saudi Arabia alone. So this is always at the back of our mind, is a matter of worry what would happen. So that is one element in which there are these security concerns. And I think when we talk of a strategic partnership and when we look at a kind of a strategic dialogue between these two countries, between our country and Saudi Arabia, this would be one element. The second would be again the Israeli role in this whole region and how Israel and also Israel itself is under a domestic flux, how it would relate either on the surface or under the surface with many of these Gulf countries. There were also issues relating to Qatar and UAE and Saudi Arabia. We don't hear about that very much anymore. I think perhaps the professor will be able to tell us. I haven't tracked this. Then with regard to the issues of, let's say, the Islamic issues or issues relating to Muslims, as we have said, Saudis have shown understanding. They have agreed. They have accepted our exposition on this or the way we have formulated it, that this is an internal affair of India. No one needs to what we are trying to do has its own compulsions, is for the good of the people of Jammu and Kashmir and of the communities therein. And I think they have shown a great deal of understanding, but I agree with Pramit that there would be a perhaps a it may not come out in the public, but that there would be a greater we expect a greater understanding of the way the situation is evolving.
Sure.
And therefore, in their own way, signals to be conveyed maybe to Pakistan or maybe to other countries about the way we intend to do that. I must mention that the Prime Minister is going primarily or explicitly as the lead speaker for the future investment summit in Saudi Arabia. They regard 8 countries as strategic partners. These are all important countries: UK, France, Germany, US, China, and so on. So there is the investment dimension. There, I would say, since you asked me specifically about the concerns, I think investment promises have to be made. We are aware, not only with regard to Saudi Arabia, but in many other cases too, that much depends on the pace of implementation,
right,
and our ability to do these projects. So I guess that too, it's not a matter of concern, but it is a serious matter, because we have to prove that we have the capacity to absorb these large figures that are being talked about.
Sure.
So I'm sure some of these mechanisms would address that issue as well. Another interesting issue is, what would this strategic partnership mean in terms of not only defense, but also in terms of intelligence, in terms of counter-terrorism and understanding of terrorism? It's easy enough for us to say that we are both against terrorism and that terrorism has no justification. We have all these standard formulations. But what do we have? What do we mean when we talk about terrorism? We talk about cross-border terrorism, and we have a particular country in mind. We all know that. Saudis too talk about terrorism, but they have another country in mind.
Right.
So it is easier to say this in nice words, but in a dialogue, I think, which is our main concern with regard to terrorism, that becomes an interesting issue.
Right.
And we both have to talk about that too.
Sure.
And intelligence sharing, I think the NSA had gone there before. This is an important issue, both intelligence sharing and tracking the financial flows, whether it is in the FATF or somewhere. In all these areas, Saudi Arabia is an important country, and we don't necessarily see everything the same way, and therein lies the importance of a strategic dialogue at different levels.
Absolutely, absolutely. And Professor, from this visit, what is it that we will be looking to get out of this visit, and what is it that the Saudis will be looking to get out of this visit, and what are our expectations really?
Before I answer, there are just two concerns for the question you raised. One is the stability, political stability in Saudi Arabia should be of concern to us. Because if the king were to be out of the scene, if the crown prince were to become king, you know, there are eyebrows raised within the Saudi kingdom, because the family is not as united as it has been in several decades, because he had arrested quite a few senior princes from across the board, and there's a lot of disaffection about his policies, whether it is Yemen or Qatar or Iran or Turkey or even the United States. So that smooth succession, which is expected, which has been happening, you know, might be a question mark, putting all the eggs in this young crown prince, who has not been able to manage his family relationship and also his foreign policy, which is termed as adventurism. This is one. The second one is because of the Iranian attacks or the attacks on Saudi Aramco facilities, the American soldiers have been deployed. You would recall that when Saddam Hussein walked into Kuwait, they had King Fahad had sought American troops, and that there was a backlash. Al-Qaeda rose, and it was a big problem of terrorism within Saudi kingdom, and much larger regionally and globally. So the defense and political stability has to be monitored very closely, because it has implications on Indo-Saudi relations, because of excessive focus on MBS may not be wise. This is one caution. The second one is the Saudis have not put the GCC in order, because they are focused only on Bahrain and UAE. Mm. You know, the other three powers, Kuwait and Oman, also are not happy. Like Qatar has been for various reasons, because of its Iran alliance or Muslim Brotherhood, etc. But overall, I think the expectations from the Indo-Saudi relations has been to keep the Saudis on our side. Mm. On a variety of issues, because it has worked on Pakistan. The Saudis, who were very stridently in favor of Pakistan's stand in OIC and bilaterally also, because even this time the Saudi Minister of State Adil Al Jubair with the UAE Foreign Minister went soon after our move on Kashmir, and what they said and what the Pakistani Foreign Minister said were quite different things. So in that way, they don't want to rock the boat as far as Indo-Saudi relations are concerned. So, and the second thing should be how to use Saudi influence to control the terrorism aspect from Pakistan. Mm. And they are willing to cooperate with us on a variety of issues in counter-terrorism also there in the region. So in that way, the key areas where we wanted to focus, we have achieved reasonable success, and we have to maintain this whether it is MBS or post-Salman phase. The other aspects like Indian workers and trade and investments and naval exercises, political relations, these will follow. But I think as a major power, we should also caution them about Yemen, because it has implications on maritime security. We don't want another Somalia and piracy to affect our and other maritime users in this region, and also it has potential to spill over into Oman.
Right.
So the entire Arabian coast, which is very close to the Indian west coast, should not become a
hotbed
for piracy in future. And lastly, I would also say that still there is struggle between Turkey and Saudi Arabia in this region. Iran is now acknowledged as a regional power like Israel, but now the contestation between Turkey and Saudi Arabia, it's still the race is going on, although the Americans are now tilting towards Turkey because of the lack of capability from Saudi Arabia, because it is vulnerable. Although it is trying to diversify with Russia, with China, with India, but still the instability might affect. In that way, we have to keep other players also in the loop as far as this region is concerned.
And Pramit, you know, as far as the visit is concerned, can we expect, you know, something as far as new avenues are concerned? Is that something that both India and Saudi Arabia are exploring, trying to look beyond the traditional aspects of the relationship?
I think the military one will be the new one. That will be the, I mean, it's already been leaked to the press, but the public announcement of developing a military relationship, I think, will be there. We have already begun naval exercises with the United Arab Emirates, which in many ways has been the front runner of everything we do with Saudi Arabia. Intelligence sharing has already begun. The Pathankot attack, for example, it was Saudi intelligence that helped us identify all the attackers as being members of Lashkar and Pakistani. And that will continue. And that will be useful because it sends a signal to Pakistan, just the meeting and what happens there, that they cannot count on Saudi, they should not expect Saudi Arabia to help them regarding whatever India may do to them. It'll be curious to see where the energy relationship goes. We've already made an announcement that they will plan to add to our strategic oil reserves, again following in the footsteps of the United Arab Emirates. And there's an expectation that Saudi Arabia will add further to that. Our problem really is that our own capacity to absorb more oil is now reaching a certain saturation point. And the Saudis would like some clarity on their investment plans. They have now five or six different plans in the air regarding petrochemical investments. And they really want to be able to get a clear signal from the Indian government as to which of them they should be going down, or one or two of them perhaps. And I think we'll also see the Saudi Sovereign Wealth Fund, the PIF, look to be investing in other infrastructure projects, maybe highways or ports or something else, airports maybe, something other than just the energy area, because I know the Indian government is very eager for them to look into other avenues, not just the energy side, given our own requirements for foreign capital. So those are the areas, and there will be an attempt to develop this e-visa idea so that it'll be easier for Indians and Sauds to visit in their respective countries. So those are the areas that I see that forward movement. I don't expect too much discussion on regional issues. India is wary about getting involved in that that type of area. We may ask for them to help in terms of holding the line in Afghanistan, because they are a country that has influence there. Those are the only areas I really don't see. I don't see much more beyond that in this visit.
Closing comments. I'm taking closing comments from everyone. So yeah, you can
start.
Professor,
I just wanted to add one or two points. One is the Saudis are worried about their investments as far as land acquisition is concerned. The Ratnagiri Petrochemical Complex, you know, has been on and off for quite some time because of this land acquisition. Secondly, the court cases, they are worried, they want guarantees from the government of India that their investments are reasonably safe and that, you know, litigation would not drag or tend to discourage other investment. The other areas, two areas they have been looking for quite some time is they want their nuclear scientists to be trained and also in space. They have a very ambitious program in these two fields. They want Indian cooperation in this field, and I think we have not been so far enthusiastic for various reasons.
Right.
So this is, I thought I'll flag.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for flagging those particular issues as well. Ambassador, your closing comments on the program?
I feel that in a macro sense, the distance that you have already traveled with the Gulf countries in general and Saudi Arabia in particular is remarkable because it has multiple effects. One is really, to some extent, even domestically, politically. You know, we didn't have these kind of equations that we have with the UAE, with Saudi Arabia earlier. So that is some kind of messaging in itself that we do not have problems, or the Islamic world in general doesn't have problems with us, and that it's only one or two countries which have created these problems. The second is also the economic, from being looking only at trade and limited amounts of investment, we are talking of big things.
Sure.
So that again is transformative. So as Saudi Arabia also transforms itself, they are also looking at really completely starting a whole range of downstream industries. I think there might be opportunities there for Indian businesses, for skills. Aramco investing in Reliance, there could be other kinds of things which emerge. So I think on the whole, there are reasons for satisfaction at the way it's developing. The one concern I would say is this rather difficult balancing act that we have to do between Saudi Arabia and Iran.
Sure.
And that's likely to continue.
Okay, all right. And Pramit, close the show for us with a concluding remark.
Yeah, I'll just say that unlike the United Arab Emirates, the UAE under Crown Prince bin Zayed has almost completely cut off their strategic relationship with Pakistan. That was one of the reasons, it was many ways the big shift in our Gulf policy in 2015. And both on the economics and on the military side, bin Zayed was very clear in his meetings with the Prime Minister that that part of his relationship with Pakistan is over. That is not the case with Saudi Arabia. They maintain a military relationship that continues because of both on the military army side, but also because of the nuclear, the covert nuclear understanding that they have between each other. So we know that there's always going to be a bit of a limitation with Saudi Arabia regarding Pakistan. All we can ask for is that they separate the relationship. But we know there'll always be, they'll always have to maintain a tie with Pakistan, which is one of the reasons for our reluctance on the nuclear and space side.
Sure. All right. Okay. On that note, then, I'll call it a wrap on this edition of India as well. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. We'd like to hear from you as well. Do share your feedback and suggestions with us. Our email ID is indiasworld.feedback@gmail.com. You can also tweet to us using our Twitter handles at FRP09 and at Rajyasabha TV. That's it from me. See you again next time.